Good morning. I hope you can all hear me, because today what happened, the mic is not working. So I hope you can hear me clearly. Till yesterday we did a lot of programming. So from today onwards, for a couple of days, we won't be having any programming. So today we're going to talk about source code, what is source code, and libraries and compilation. Okay. So let's talk about that. So until yesterday, we were talking about programming. We were doing some programming in programming languages. All those languages were interpreted, okay, interpreted languages. So that means you don't have to compile those languages into a machine language before you run it. So you just had to type your source code into a file, and your interpreter, such as Bash or Awk, what it would do is it would read each line of code, and it would dynamically execute whatever that code, the instructions for that code. For example, if you want to do some arithmetic, the interpreter would read that line, perform that operation, and then it would move on to the next line and execute that. So it's done by step, it reads your source code and interprets it on the fly. Now, most of the programs we use, like CAT and Awk, these programs are written in high-level languages, in C, Fortran, in C mostly, the Unix utilities are written in C. So these high-level languages need to be compiled. So you remember in the first class I told you that the CPU only speaks in a binary language. The CPU, the central processing unit, only understands binary. All the instructions are in binary form, ones and zeros. So before we can run a program on the CPU, we need to convert it into this binary code. This is called machine language. Now, writing a program in machine language is as you would expect, it's very difficult. If you're going to write binary code manually, it's going to be really difficult. So this is a language just on top of machine language. It's just a slightly higher abstraction on top of machine language. It's called assembly language. Assembly language is like a text-based language. Okay, and assembly language, in assembly language, each instruction has a corresponding instruction in machine code. Okay, but assembly language is a little bit more easier to remember than binary. So assembly language is slightly higher level language than machine code. But still, as writing code in assembly language is difficult. Now, machine language, like I said earlier, machine language is specific to your hardware. So the binary code that a chip, that your CPU interprets, for example, the add instruction has a certain binary code. Now, this certain binary code for performing the add instruction depends. Yeah. So the binary code for performing an instruction, like addition, this binary code is different depending on the actual chip or the manufacturer or even the version of the chip. So you have a new CPU today, there's a CPU going to be released tomorrow. The binary code that's going to make it do some operations is going to change. So if you're writing code in machine language, you have to change your program every time a new chip comes out, or every time you want to run your program on a different processor. Now the same thing goes for assembly language. Assembly language is specific to a certain family of processors. For example, all the Intel processors and AMD processors we use, they have an instruction set called x86 instruction set. So you need to know that instruction set if you're going to write an assembly language program. And this program, if you want to move your program to another processor family, again, you have to change your code. So the solution to this is you write programs in high-level languages. So high-level languages like C, C++, and Fortran. Now the syntax, the language, now Bash and Awk, which you talked about, they're also high-level languages. What's good about high-level languages is that it's easier to read, it's easier to understand, and easier to write programs. The thing about, now the other thing about high-level languages is that they're independent of the hardware. Okay. So you can take your high-level language, write a program in your language like C, and you can compile that program on computer X. Now you can take that same program without modifying it and compile it on another hardware, and it's going to work. Yeah, because it's independent of the hardware. So there's a word for this, you say the program is portable. Okay. You say it's portable. So C is a portable language. Okay. You can port your program from one system to another. You can compile it. Now, you'll find that generally people don't write programs. But there are certain occasions when people do write programs in assembly. They don't write entire programs. They usually write small parts of larger programs. For example, your large program will be written in C. Maybe a small portion will be written in assembly. The reason is that if you want to take, suppose you want to take advantage of some particular new hardware that has come out, Okay, so your C compiler probably doesn't know about the hardware. What you do is you write some assembly code instructions to make use of that hardware. So when you need performance, when you need some particular performance, some part of your program needs high performance or does it needs to use a special part of your hardware, you write that portion alone in assembly. So the rest of your program will be written in a high-level language. So the assembler is a program that converts assembly code to machine code. And the compiler is what converts your high-level language into machine code. So before you run your program, which is written in a high-level language or assembly language, you need to convert it into machine language first. So that's the process we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about this compilation process. The whole process of converting your source code, which is written in C or Fortran, into machine code, which is ready to be executed by your computer. So I was talking about source code. The source code is the input you give to your compiler. So your C language or Fortran language program which you write, this is a source code. And the output of the compiler is your executable. You get an executable. That's a program that is ready to run. You can type the name of the program, it's going to run, do whatever you programmed it for. Now the executable contains machine language code along with some instructions which are specific to your operating system. For example, if you create an executable for Linux, it's different from the executable we create on Windows. Now, certain parts of it might be the same, okay, but there are some operating system specific parts which change. So on Linux, the compilation of a source code into an executable takes place in four stages. The first stage is preprocessing, compilation, assembly, and linking. These are the four stages of compilation. Okay, so you provide the source code, preprocessing is done, compilation, assembly, linking, and then you get the executable. So we'll discuss each of these stages, what actually happens behind the scenes. Okay. Now, in all these examples, we're talking about the GNU C compiler. Okay, we're going to show examples in C, and we're going to use this compiler to change the C code into machine language. Now, everything I say here applies even to Fortran compilers. Okay, so there's a GNU Fortran compiler also. Most of the options you can supply to the Fortran compiler are the same as the C compiler. Okay, everything I say applies there also. So you can just replace the GCC command with a GFortran command. Now the options which I mentioned are specific to the GNU C compiler. If you're using another commercial compiler like iFoot, they have the same options, but maybe the option names are changing. But let's concentrate on the open source compiler which is available to us. So this is a C program. If you don't know C, don't worry about this. It's just an example. You don't really need to know what the program does. I just want to show you these two particular lines. Now the first stage of compilation is preprocessing. Okay. So what does preprocessing do? In preprocessing, you pass your source code into a preprocessor, and it performs some transformation on your source code and gives out an output which is preprocessed. Now if you look at your program, this program, it's just C code. Now these two particular lines begin with a hash character, right? These two are called preprocessor directives. Now these two lines are really not seen by the C compiler. The C compiler never sees these lines. And the C compiler is not going to translate these lines into any machine code. So only this part of the program is going to be compiled into machine code. This is going to be seen by the preprocessor and it's going to do something. So the preprocessor, when it sees something that begins with a hash, it knows that it's a preprocessor directive and it's going to perform some action based on that. So the preprocessor does three things mainly. It does string substitution, macro expansion, okay, comment removal. Okay, that's what it does, things like that. So we'll just show you an example. So look at the first. Okay, before we go into preprocessing, I'll just show you how you compile this program. This program, if you want to compile this program into executable on Linux, you just give this command, gcc-o test and the source code. So our source file is named test.c. The contents of test.c is what we show over here. And the hyphen o option to gcc tells what the name of the output file should be. So your output executable file will be named test. Now in case you don't supply this O option, GCC will choose a default name for your executable that is a.out. Right? So if you don't want a file named a.out executable, you should supply a name with the O option. Now when GCC compiles a program and produces an executable file, the executable file is in a format called ELF, the executable and linkable format. This is a standard format you'll find on on all Linux systems. Of course, Linux supports other formats for executables, but this is a standard format you'll find on all Linux systems. So if you ran the file command, you remember the file command you put in the first day, it tells you what type of file it is. If you run the file command on executable, which is produced by GCC or G4TRAN, any compiler, it's going to be the ELF format. Now, once you've compiled your program, your C program, in order to run it from your current working directory, you just write ./test. Okay? ./ and the name of the program. And you get the output. Now, for this particular program, let's follow each stage of the compilation, the four stages we talked about, and see what happens. Now, we'll go to preprocessing. So, like I said earlier, preprocessor performs text substitution, macro expansion, comment removal, and file inclusion. Okay? So, like I said, look at this first line, #include/stdio.h. Okay? This is a preprocessor directive. What this directive tells a preprocessor, now stdio.h is a file. Okay? It's a file which contains C code, contains C source code, just like this file. What the include does is it tells the preprocessor to take the entire contents of stdio.h and include it over here. Okay? So it takes the contents of stdio.h and just places it over there. Now suppose stdio.h in turn includes some other files. Suppose stdio.h inside the .h file, it has similar lines. It's going to include those also. Okay? So every file that's included in stdio.h and stdio.h is going to be included over here. So suppose you took your source code and split it into two files, you could just include one of the files in the other and source code is just going to be placed there. Okay, so it's a very simple operation. What it does is it just takes that text and puts it over there. Nothing great. Now look at the second preprocessor directive. It's a #define, a name and some value. So this is text substitution inside the preprocessor. So what the preprocessor does is when it sees this, okay, wherever, anywhere in your program, if you find the string A value, it's going to replace it with the number 5. Okay, it's just substituting one string with another. Okay, very simple operation. So wherever, so here you can see, we've included the value A value. Okay, the word A value. When the preprocessor is processing this file, in the output of the preprocessor, it's going to replace this with 5. So suppose you want to see what your pre-processed source code looks like. In that case, you would give the GCC-E option. And it's going to write the pre-processed output to standard output. Now since it's writing to standard output, we want to redirect it to a file so that we can look at it later. Right? Now if you look at this, so we are taking the pre-processed output and writing it to test.txt. If you look at this txt file, it has 860 lines. That's because it included the contents of stdio.h and also the files which stdio.h itself included. This has a lot of lines. And it also adds a lot of housekeeping lines, certain lines which only the GCC compiler can understand. The reason is, suppose you get an error while compiling your program, the GCC compiler needs to know which line that error came from. So in that case, if you just had all your lines in one file, it can't tell whether this line came from stdio.h or from some other header file or from your own program. So the preprocessor adds some special lines which tells the GCC compiler where each line came from. Okay. So let's look at the part. So we'll cut a lot of that 860 lines and we'll look at the part which you're interested in. So this is a preprocessed output. Okay. This is the output of the preprocessor. Notice that the A value has been replaced with the number 5. Okay, and there was a comment over here. The comment is removed. So comments, the comment began with a double forward slash. That's a comment. Okay, that is code. That is a line which is not going to be converted to any code. So the preprocessor removes all that, and this is the code which is going to be passed to the compiler. So the preprocessing command actually, when you run GCC-E, it's actually running a program called CPP in the backend. So CPP is called the C preprocessor. Okay, this is the one that actually converts, processes your text file and produces the output you just saw. Now CPP is generally designed for working with C files, but it's general enough to work with other languages, but sometimes certain type of input can cause it to break. So it's generally designed for C, but it can also work for Fortran code. Okay, you can input hash defines and hash includes the program. It's going to do the same thing. Now the next stage of compilation is a conversion. Now you have your pre-processed source code. Now this pre-processed source code is going to be converted into assembly language. So the GCC compiler is going to take the source code and compile it into assembly language. So if you want to see the assembly language output, suppose you don't want executable, you just want it to stop after producing assembly language, you pass a hyphen capital S to GCC. Okay, it's going to produce assembly code. This is what assembly code looks like. Okay, so this is the language that I told you, which is just above machine language. Okay, it's got some words which you can recognize, but it's still very difficult to write programs like this. So in the next stage of compilation, this assembly language is going to be converted into machine code. Right? So that is done by the assembler. So the assembler takes the assembly language and converts it into machine code. Now this machine code which you get, okay, you'll get it in the form of an object file. It's called an object file. Now an object file is not an executable. You can't take an object file and just run it. Okay, this object file contains machine code, but it's not ready to be run, because it does not have the operating system specific code which we talked about. So earlier we said that executable will have some machine code and some operating system specific code, that is some startup code and some ending code. So startup code is what the OS uses to start the program. So all this code is missing. You just have plain machine code, your program converted into machine code. Now the last stage in linking, now this is the stage that actually produces your executable as the output. Now the linking stage takes input as one or more object files. Okay? The input for the linker. The linking stage is done by a program called the linker. So the input for the linker is one or more object files. Now remember, object file is just machine code. It takes these object files and produces an executable. So what does a linker do? Before producing an executable, the linker adds the startup and the ending code, which we told you, the operating system specific code. That code is added by the linker. But there's something more important that the linker does, and that is it merges object files together. So I'll just explain that in the next slide. So at the end of the linking stage, what you get is an executable. And the executable is what you can run with the dot slash, like the programming material, dot slash test. So that's the executable. So that's the last stage of compilation. Now, the important part of the linker, what it does is it resolves dependencies. This is the important part of the linker's job. So suppose you wrote a program in some language like C or Fortran. You can split your program into multiple source files. Okay, you can write the main part of your program in one source file, and in another source file, you can write a function. Okay, like a subroutine. You heard of subroutines and functions? So suppose your main program needs to use the function square root. You can write the square root function in another file. Okay, separately, just that function. And your main program would call that function. What you would do is you would compile each of these separately into an object file. So one object file contains your main program, the other object file contains your square root function. So the main program is calling the square root function, but it doesn't actually have the code for it. The actual code for the square root function is contained in another object file. Now it's a linker's job. It's a linker's job to merge these two files together. What it does is when the linker has more than one object file, it links these files together. So you have your main program. So you have your main program, which calls the function square root. Okay, but the code for square root is not there in this program. The code for square root is in another object file. Okay, this is one object file, another object file. What the linker does, it's going to merge these two into a single object file. And then it's going to look at the square root function and add pointers to that. Okay, it's going to take care, it's going to resolve the dependency. Okay, this is called linking. That's why we call it linking. It's going to link every function call. So every function call in this main, which is not defined, which is not there, for which the code is not there, the linker is going to find it and then make the link into the correct object file. And then all of these object files are going to be merged into one single executable. So So you can have one or more object files. For example, suppose main calls another function. Instead of square root, it's calling from some function, a cube or something. You can have a cube function in yet another object file. Okay, and the linker takes care of linking it. Now there's one advantage of having. Now why would you want to create separate object files for different functions and then link them at the end? You could just put everything in one single program, right? And then compile it into with one single object file. Now why would you want to do that? Now keeping functions separate like this in different object files provides a good way to organize common code. Okay. So we have our cube function and our square root function. Suppose you had a new program. You had a new program called main2, and this program also used the cube and the square root function. Okay, so you have this you have these two object files, and you have this program. Now you got this new program, which uses these same functions. Now you don't need to compile this again. You just need to use the linker and link this new program to these lines. Whatever you have here. Okay? So you already have your square root and cube function with you. You have two object files. It's machine code, so it's ready. It's there on your computer. Now when you get a new program which uses these functions, you just need to link with it. Okay? So it has two...
These files are saved as what
files? These are .o files. .o, yeah. They're object files. So okay, so maybe an example would be better. So in our example, let's create some custom math functions. We're going to create some math functions of our own. Okay, not some standard math functions. Just our own math functions. Now, several programs can reference our math functions. So like I showed you earlier, you can have one main program which calls your math function, square root and cube. You can have another program which also calls our functions. The only thing is, you have the object files for your two functions. You just need to link them at the end. Okay. So what's the advantage of doing this? What it does, it eases compilation. So I told you that we had our two functions with our custom code, okay, cubed and square root. You just need to compile these two once. Okay. You compile these two files once, you get a .o file, you get an object file. Now, no matter how many programs you have that utilize these two functions, you don't need to recompile this again. You just need to link whatever object file you get with these object files. So suppose you had a main program, a new main program that used any of these functions. You would just compile that program alone. You'll get an object file. Now, that object file will be calling these functions which are not defined over there. You just link with these. So it saves you compilation. You just have to compile your object, these functions, object files, only once. And then link your program with it. So that's one advantage. The other advantage eases distribution. So suppose you create some special math functions, okay, and you distribute it, okay, like over the internet, people download it. And now you suppose the next step is you distribute some programs which use these functions. Now whenever you distribute a new program which uses these functions, you do not need to include these again with it. Right? You just distribute your program because people already have your functions. They already have the object file having your functions. So the only thing you need to do is you need to send the object file of your main program. What the user needs to do is he needs to link it with this and starts working. Okay, so you save. So when you're distributing code, you don't need to distribute this common code every time you distribute code that uses it. So whenever we create a new program that needs to use cubed or square root, we don't need to send the whole cubed and square root function again. Just send it once, and then every other program can be linked to it. So if you have several object files like this, several functions, you can bunch them together into a single file, and then we call it a static library. Okay, this is called a static library. So we'll see an example. Okay, maybe it'll hopefully make this clear.
There's also an advantage of proprietorship and so on. I don't need to give away my source code.
Yes. So that's important. If you distribute code as an object file, okay, it's it's generally difficult to obtain the source code. So this is compiled code, it's machine language code, right? It's difficult to convert machine language code back into source code. Okay, you can't do it. So what it does is, the advantage of distributing files in the form of object code is that people cannot change your code and they cannot know how your code is written. Okay, so suppose you've written a library that's really fast, okay, it uses some special algorithm to do things really quick, and you don't want somebody else to be using your algorithm. You distribute your library as an object file. Okay, so people don't know how it works, but they can just link it and use it, but they can't know how it works. Okay, so people can look at the machine code, but it's really difficult to interpret what a program is doing by looking at the machine code. So let's see an example. We'll create a small static library to illustrate what we said until now. So look at this main program, testlink.c. Okay, it's a C program. Okay, for those of you who don't program C, don't worry. So this program, I hope you can see this portion. So in this program, this is the main function that the program calls. Okay, this is the main function, this is the main line that the program executes. We're not doing anything. We're assigning a variable x with this value, 23.1415. We're calling the function cubed with that value, okay, and storing the result in y. Okay, then we're calling another function power 4, again with the x value and storing the result in y, and we're printing this y value. So you don't need to know what the program does, but notice that we're calling two functions, cubed and power 4. We're calling two functions, but nowhere in the program can you find this function actually defined. Okay, so the code for cubed and power 4 is not there in this program. We're just calling a function without actually knowing what the function does. Okay, so you can't find anywhere. So here we're just giving the name of cubed so that we can tell it what the parameter is. So this is called a function declaration in C. Just ignore this. So we're calling the function cubed and power 4 and we're using it in our program, but we're not defining it anywhere. So what we'll do is we'll define these two functions in separate files. So this is in testlink.c. We'll create two more files which have our special functions. So those are special functions which we want to use. So we'll define two separate files with this function, cubed and power 4 function. So look at this file, libcube.c. Okay, this is again a C source file. It just has a definition of the cube function. Okay, just the cube function. So what does this function do? It just returns a cubed as a number. A very simple function. And we have this C file, lib power 4. This one returns the number raised to power 4. Okay, so we have all these three separate files. Now what do we do next? We need to compile. We need to tell GCC to produce object files. Okay, we want to produce these object files. So how do you tell GCC to produce object files? You pass the hyphen C option. So if you don't give any options to GCC, it produces an executable. But we don't want an executable, we just want an object file. So you give the hyphen C option. And we need to compile our two library functions, libcubed, our cubed function and our power 4 function into object files. So this is a command we use. GCC-C, the name of our first function file, okay, libcube.c, and the name of our second function file, libpower4.c. Okay? So what's the result you'll get? You'll get two files. You'll get libcubed, .o, and you'll get power4.o. You'll get two O files, two object files. Okay. Now what we want to do is we want to combine these two object files into one single static library. Okay. For that we'll use the command called AR. Okay. AR stands for archive. So the AR command is very similar to the tar command. You remember the tar command? What does it do? It takes many files and directories and then puts them together into a single file. Okay, and you can extract it back. So the AR does the same thing. It takes these two files, libcube.o and libpower4.o, and puts them together in this archive, libmymath.a. So generally when you're putting object files into an archive, the conventional name is to end it with a .a. Okay, so this, you can recognize the static library by this. Now the RS options to AR, the R option tells AR to add these files to that archive. The S option tells it to produce an index. So generally you would pass the RS option when you're creating this library. So now we have our two object files archived into a single library file, libmymath.a. Okay, now let's use our library and link it to our main program. Now suppose you compile testlink.c. Suppose you compile testlink.c without supplying any library. So you just give hyphen gcc hyphen o testlink, like the first gcc command we showed you. Gcc hyphen o testlink and the name of our source file. Look at the error that you get. It writes a lot, but the main thing you want to see is here. In function main, there's an undefined reference to cubed. And over here, there's an undefined reference to power 4. That means you're calling a function called cubed, and you're calling a function called power 4, but these two functions are not defined anywhere. So it doesn't know what code these functions have. Okay, so this is the error you get when you don't link your library in. So let's link our library in. So if you want to link the library in, you just put it at the end of your GCC command line. Okay, so the same command, GCC, I don't know, testlink.c, you give a library. Okay. So what GCC is going to do is going to compile this and link this library into it. So now you don't get any error, and you'll get the output. You'll get your executable, which you can run. Right? So now you split your source into three source files, and you link them together. Okay? In effect, what you created is you created your own library of math functions. The cube function and the libpowerfor. Now you can write any program which uses the cubed and the libpowerfor function. And the only thing is when you compile it, you need to link it with this. So you need only one copy of this with you.
Square root.
Yes.
So then in that case, in this link libraries you have this.
Only these two functions. Yes, yes. Yeah, so you could create one more object file with the square root function and then you could add that to that archive. So you could add it to this. So you can add more than one, more than two. So suppose I created one more object file with the square root function, I would just add it to this archive. And then I could link any program which needed that function. So the R and the S are options to the AR command. R tells it to add these two to the... So suppose you already had an archive and you want to add more O files to it, the R option would add it to that. And the S option tells it to produce an index. So index makes linking faster.
Is it possible to add our own library to the standard libraries permanently so that whenever we use cube, we don't have to call this library?
What do you mean by standard library?
Already some scripts are there which are written in that
program.
Right.
So
now we are adding our own code,
like
some extra library.
Yes.
So
we incorporate this in the already existing.
For example, we can include our file by using that include hash include thing. Can we do that?
Yeah, so the hash include is just a header file. So this is an object file, this is actual machine code. Okay, so the header file usually contains only a function declaration. It doesn't actually have code. So it depends on how you want to distribute your program. You could distribute your entire source file, or you could just distribute the library. Okay. Now typing this is exactly equivalent to typing this. Okay. So you can type gcc-o testlink.c. Instead of typing your archive files as having all your object files, you could list each individual object file on the command line. Now you notice I put a slash here. The slash here in bash, the slash tells you that your line is continuing. Okay, if you put a slash as the last character, you're going to get the secondary prompt in bash and you can continue typing the rest of it. So you can type a line like gcc-o test testing.c and you can list each object file. Now suppose you had 100 special math functions. It's going to be really inconvenient to specify all of this. So that's when we use this archive. This AR command to list to put everything into a single static library, and then you just have to link that into it. Yeah, because we're going to talk about dynamic. Okay. So static. Now we talk about some disadvantages of static libraries. Yeah. So like I told you earlier, when you have a static library during the linking stage, the linker actually merges all these together, right? It merges all of them together into a single executable file. Okay, so the actual code from all these objects is merged together. And then what it does, it links, it takes care of dependencies. So suppose one function, one object file is calling a function present in another object file, it's going to make sure that the addresses match and all that. So linker does this. Now what's the advantage of this? The disadvantage. Now the disadvantage is every executable you create and link with the object file actually contains the code of the object file in it. Okay? Suppose you had some object files with some math functions, okay, .o, 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 and you downloaded some new program which needs to be linked to these. So you download some .o program or some .c program which you compile into .o. And then you link all of these to get your executable. Now your executable is going to contain the code of all three of these. Now suppose you download another program and you compile into .o, and then again you link it with this. This program is also going to have a copy of all this code in it. So every executable you create is going to have a copy of the actual code in your object files, in your library. Now what's the disadvantage? Suppose your libraries are really large. Okay, you have really large libraries, very large libraries. Suppose you have a large number of libraries. Every executable file is going to have a copy of it, right? So you're going to have really big executables, especially if your code is large. Okay? So that's one disadvantage. Now another disadvantage is, when you run a program, you might remember in the first or second class I said, when you run a program, what does the operating system do? It reads the program from the hard disk, okay, it maps that program into main memory. Okay, it takes your program, puts it into main memory, and then tells the CPU to start executing that code which is in main memory. So what happens here? Suppose you have two programs which are linked with your very large libraries, okay, and you're executing both these programs together. Okay, you're executing two of them, okay, two separate programs. In your main memory, you're going to have one, your first process is going to be the first program, the second process is going to be the second program. Now you'll have this exact same code duplicated in your main memory, right? So each program's full content is moved into main memory, and the content of this program is also moved into main memory and is executed together. Okay? You're executing both programs at the same time. Now each program has a copy of your library. Okay, this is a waste. Okay, the code is exactly the same, but it's present in two places in main memory. Now this program cannot share the library code which is present in this program. So that's another disadvantage. You're wasting memory by having multiple copies of your library code present in main memory. So the solution for both of these is to use dynamic libraries. We're going to talk about dynamic libraries. So what's the difference between static and dynamic libraries? So dynamic libraries, static libraries, during the compilation stage, the last stage of compilation is linking, right? So the linking stage is when your object files are combined together and the dependencies are resolved, right? But in dynamic libraries, the resolution, okay, the resolving of dependencies is done not during compilation time, it's done during runtime. So you have an executable file, okay, that executable file might be calling functions which it doesn't know, okay, which doesn't have a definition of. But the operating system, okay, when you run that program, the moment you run it, the operating system takes care of linking the program with the correct library. Okay, so it's done at runtime when you run your program. So in static linking is done during compilation time, in dynamic libraries is done during during runtime. So that's what I wrote here. References are resolved during runtime. So what's the disadvantage? What's the catch of having things being done at runtime? The catch is that you have to have your library code around when you run your program. Okay, so you remember this, what your linker used to do in the static linking cases is going to take this object code, merge it together and produce an executable. So the executable has the library code in it. But in dynamic linking, your executable does not have the library code in it. So the catch is that when you run your program, you have to have your library program available. Only then can the operating system link your library functions with your main program code.
Yes, sir. By the time you were talking about that static linking,
yes.
Before that, when you compile that GCC -o,
yes.
Only test link.c, it gave error.
Yes, yes.
So that
it was trying to merge,
yes,
these files.
Okay. You are talking about dynamic. Linking,
right.
So you are saying we are going to link that only after compilation.
Yeah, so you will we'll finish
the in the execution state we are going to
Right.
But won't then it will give
that error? Yeah. So the
is that
the
that runtime error or something?
No, that's a compile time error. So that error is during compilation.
Okay.
So we'll use some special options in GCC.
Okay.
So it doesn't complain about undefined symbols.
Okay.
And then it will just produce an executable. Okay. So GCC won't complain, it will produce an executable. And then when you run it, the dynamic linker of the operating system will take care of hooking up the libraries. We'll see how that's done. So the advantage is, so there's one thing, your library should be available during runtime. The other thing is your executables will be smaller, okay? Because your executables don't have the actual library code present in them. The third advantage is that the operating system, whenever the operating system does linking, dynamic linking, it keeps only one copy of the library in memory, okay? One copy of your library code is present in memory. And whenever you run a program that is using this library, it loads that program into memory and then links it to this,
okay,
in memory. So all the programs that use your common function, okay, they're calling the same function in memory. They're sharing the same piece of library code. Okay, so you don't have that code duplication in your memory like we showed in static linking case. So these are the advantages of dynamic linking. So what we'll do is we'll recreate our earlier library, our libcubed and our libpower4. We'll recreate them so that they're dynamic. Okay? So let's do that. Now the first stage for creating a dynamic library is you need to generate something called position independent code. Okay? PIC, position independent code. So you'll notice that if I remove this PIC option, the GCC command is exactly the same as I did earlier for generating object code. GCC-C, libcube.c, libpower4.c, the same command, but I just added this option. -F PIC. Okay, this case sensitive. What it does is it produces a certain type of code called position independent code. Okay. So what's the output you get? You get the same output. You get a .o file. You get libcube.o and you get libpower4.o. Okay, so now you have position independent code. Now we need to combine this into a dynamic library. So we're not going to use the AR command. We're going to use GCC itself. So how do you combine it? We use the GCC-shared option. So this command line looks a little long. I'll tell you what each option does. So you have the GCC command. The -shared option tells GCC to produce a shared library as output. Okay? So it's not going to produce an executable. It's going to produce a shared library. Now look at this. This is one single option. Okay, there's no spaces in between. So -WL, -SO name, lib mymath.so. So this option actually is not a GCC option, it's a linker option. So if you put -WL, it tells GCC to pass this option to the linker. Okay, the linker is actually what produces your shared library. So what does this line tell? It tells that your library should have an internal name. Okay, when you're creating a dynamic library, you can give it a name. Not just a file name, you can actually specify the name inside the library. Okay, and this is what that option does. It sets the internal library name as libmymath.so. Okay? So just don't worry about that. You just have an internal name for a library. So earlier, static libraries didn't have any internal names. You could just name it anything. You could change the name of the file. It didn't have any standard name that you could refer it by. But this one has a special name which is inside the file. So you could change that file name into anything, but the library will still be referred by this name. The rest of the options are standard. -o tells you, tells GCC what to name the output file to. So this is the output file name. So you'll notice that dynamic libraries are named with the .so extension. .so. That's this dynamic library extension. And then we supply the object files which we want to put in this library. So we want this library to contain the cubed object file. We want to contain the power4 function also. So you list those over here. So when you do this, what are you going to get? You're going to get a file named libmymath.so. Okay, that libmymath.so is your dynamic library. So we've created a dynamic library now. So let's do the compilation of our test link program again. Same command line, but instead of giving libmymath.a, we're giving libmymath.so. Okay, we're linking a dynamic library this time. So good, it compiles successfully. Right? Now we're going to run this program. So let's see what happens when you run it. We try running a program, now you get an error. Again, and it doesn't work. What does it say? It says error while loading shared libraries. libmymath.so cannot open shared object file, no such file or directory. So what happened? So when you run a program which is dynamically linked, the operating system there's a piece of the operating system that actually does the dynamic linking. So this dynamic linker searches for your library file. So I told you that the library file needs to be present when you're running the program, right? So the dynamic linker is going to be looking for your library. Linux dynamic linker has some specific directories where it looks for libraries in. Okay? So your program is linked to libmymath.so. So the dynamic linker is going to be looking for this file in these standard locations, and it's not going to find it because these files are in your current directory. So because it cannot find this library, it's going to complain and it's not going to run. So how do you fix this problem? What we need to do is we need to tell the dynamic linker where to find our library. Okay, we need to add our directory also to that set of directories where it searches for libraries. So how do we do that? So you remember we talked about environment variables, okay, in the second class. So environment variables modify the operation of some programs, right? So we have an environment variable called LD library path. Okay, so the dynamic linker, the Linux dynamic linker looks for this environment variable. So what does this environment variable contain? It contains colon separated list of directories. So you have one directory, a colon, another directory, colon, okay, a list of directories. So if you give some directories into, store some directories into this environment variable, whenever you run a program, and that program requires some dynamic library to be linked in, the dynamic linker is going to search in the directories which are listed here in LD library path. Okay, so suppose you have directory 1, 2, and 3 listed here. It's going to look in those directories also, in addition to the standard directories, it's going to look for your library file. So we need to add our current working directory to this list, to LD library path. So what's the current working directory? How do you specify that?
Dot.
Remember relative paths? So we need to add a dot to our environment variable. So look at this. You remember the syntax for creating environment variable? You put export variable name equals to value. So you have export LD library path equals to dot colon and dollar LD library path. So you remember from the shell, what does a dollar variable name do?
Expands the old
library. Right? It expands it with the value. So in case, suppose you already had LD library path set with some directories, and you wanted to add your dot directory to the beginning of that list, this is what you would do. Okay, so what does this whole thing expand to? Suppose the LD library path already had some directory in it. So suppose the LD library path already had /home/lib or something in it. After you execute this command, what is this going to expand to? This is going to expand to dot. Okay, dot is your current working directory, colon, and this, /home/lib. So this whole expansion is going to be assigned to your variable. So now the new value of LD library path is this. Okay, so now whenever you run a program, the Linux dynamic linker is going to search for libraries in all the standard directories plus these two directories. Okay, it's going to search in the current directory, it's going to search here. So we set a library path and we execute our program. Okay, it works. It's not complaining anymore because we're able to find the library. Now it's generally good practice to put absolute path names in the LD library path. So what's wrong with this, putting a dot? Yeah, so if you cd into a different directory and try to run your program, it's going to stop working because it's going to look for your library in the current working directory. So the best thing to do is you put the absolute path name here so that it works all the time, wherever you're running your program from.
So each time I run the program, I have to do this.
Your LD library path should be pointing to the directory. Or you should put your library in a standard directory.
Also have to do that.
So the standard directories are writable only by root. So if you are the administrator of the particular computer, you can copy it to the directories like /user/lib. Where /user/lib is one standard directory where the linker searches for dynamic libraries.
So I don't. SO file will be.
Just put it there, yeah. Just put the SO file.
You can put it in dot bash.
Yeah, you can put this line in dot bash. Yes.
So, you really want users to mess up with user lib?
No,
opt local users.
Opt, yeah. So generally, so you don't want to be, so suppose you do something crazy, okay? You named your library something which already exists in /user/lib, and you copied your library, it overwrote the old library. Now, this library could be something that the system needs. Okay, /user/lib and /lib contain libraries which are very essential for the running of the system. Okay, so Linux itself is a, for example, all the basic utilities in Linux, like your CDLS, all these commands, cat, they're all linked to dynamic libraries. So suppose you accidentally overwrite one of these dynamic libraries, okay, your whole system is going to stop working. So generally, you don't want to be writing your custom libraries into one of these are called system-wide libraries, okay, /user/lib is what contains libraries which are essential for system operation. You don't want to be copying it there. So the best way, if you're a normal user, if you're not root, okay, the safest way to keep your libraries is to keep it in your home directory under a certain prefix. Or if you want your library to be available to all users, you would put it in a safer location like /opt. So there's a directory in most Linux systems called /opt. Okay. /opt contains files which are not essential for system operation. And this is a place where you can put third-party libraries, third-party executables, stuff like that. So if you put your library under /opt and add that library, add this location into your LD library path, okay, then everybody can use it. Okay, so if you put in your home directory, maybe other users don't have read permissions to your library, so they won't be able to use that library. Okay. So it's a generally good idea to avoid saving it in /user and stuff. So that's a dynamic. So we created a dynamic library, we created a static library, and you know how to use them. Okay, so let's look at one more thing. So look at the error message that comes when you run GCC and you compile your testlink.c program without specifying the libraries. So remember this error, it's the same error we saw earlier. You get an undefined reference to cube, you get an undefined reference to power 4. Now you'll find that when you compile some programs, some large packages, you'll get a large number of errors like this. Okay, there's a lot of functions which are not found. Because that program links to a large number of libraries. Now suppose you have a bunch of libraries with you, okay? You have so many A files, so many .so files. You don't know which file contains this actual function, right? You don't know which file contains this function. If you knew, you could add that library file to the end and it would link to it. So how would you find this? So every object file that you create and every .so file you create contains a list of symbols. Okay, these symbols are the names of the functions, the names of the variables, and other information which is contained in that object file. Okay, so if you could search for this name cubed in all your .a or all your .so files, you could locate where that function is, whether it is defined in this object file or in another object file. So how do you do that? So we'll use a command called nm, okay, the nm command. What the nm command by itself, you just type nm in object file, it's going to print out a list of all the symbols in that particular object file. Okay, so all the names of the functions, all the names of variables, external variables. So this nm command works on static and dynamic libraries. So generally, if you want to use nm, you would use it like this. Okay? So suppose you had a directory which contained a whole lot of .so files. Okay, you have a large optlib directory with a lot of .so files. You want to locate this function. You want to know which library contains this function. You would use a command like this. So what does *.so expand to?
All
the files with .so extension. So nm is going to look at all the files with the .so extension. And whenever it files, and it's going to just print out all the symbols in all those files. Okay, it's going to print every symbol of every .so file. So look at this option, print file name. So suppose you had all the symbols of all the files printed out just like that in a list, and you grepped for power 4, you would get power 4, you would probably get power 4, but how would you know which file it belonged to? Right? So what this option does is, before printing out any symbol name, before that, it prints the name of the file from where that symbol came. Okay, so if you got libcube.so, it's going to print libcube.so:power4. Okay, so that's a symbol. So what does nm do? It's going to print all the file names It's going to print the name of the file followed by all the symbols. And what does the grep command do? Grep command prints the lines that match pattern. So what's our pattern? The word powerful. So it's going to print the lines which contain the word powerful. So this is the output you'll get. So see here, it print the line, printed the name of the file, libmymath.so, and it contains the function powerful. So these are some other information, like it tells you the value of that function, and whether it's external or internal function or that. But this is generally what you want to see. So you, we have determined that powerful is in libmymath.so. So then in your next line, you can just add libmymath.so over here.
Sure. We incorporate this concept of dynamic library was to save the CPU time. We told that...
Okay, not CPU time. So we're saving memory space.
Okay.
Okay.
So, but even at the time of compilation, again, we are calling those libraries.
Yeah.
But we are not, as you told that...
Yeah, so when you call...
you are compiling the program and you are calling the library.
This one, right?
So the library is doing the work here.
Yeah, so it doesn't actually, so earlier in the static linking case, it actually took the object files and merged it together into an executable. Over here, the merging step does not happen. It's a dynamic, if you, now I specify a dynamic library here. Okay, it doesn't actually merge the files together. Okay, what it does is it adds a link to this file inside your executable. So when we ran test.link, how did test.link know that the libmymath.so file is missing? How did it know which library is missing? Because it has no way of knowing which file. We could save the file in any name. So how did it know? Because it has this over here. Because we specified the name of the library during compilation. So it knows what library to expect. Right? Which library name to expect, which library name to look for.
Okay. So this is just for flag like...
It's like for pre-linking. Okay, so just to tell which library name to look for. Now the actual linking of code happens during untime. Yeah, so I think we're done with your early. So that is all I want to talk about.
Suppose I link against an archive containing cube.o and square root.o. But I'm using only cube. I'm calling only cube in my source code.
Yes.
Okay. And in the static case, is the whole archive mapped into the memory, or only the cube.o is mapped?
So if your object file, I'm not sure if it's an archive, but if you specify the .o files individually,
yes,
on the command line, it's going to include all of them.
Okay.
It's going to include all of them.
That's an archive.
Okay, if it's an archive, I'm not sure whether it includes all of them.
Uh-huh.
But if you took the archive and blew it up into .o files and include all the names, it's going to put all of them, whether you use it or not. So yeah, so because an archive has an index of
yes.
of the files in
yes.
it, the GCC compiler could look at that index and just include the
yeah.
ones which it needs.
Yeah. This could be important when you have commercial archives,
right,
which could have probably thousands of routines.
Yes.
.o files.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
And that could swamp my memory.
Exactly.
All
yeah.
of them.
Yeah, so you could have a large library which is having a lot of files,
yeah.
and including all of them will make your executable really large. So,
are you going to tell any examples of these archives, which not self-created archives, but existing archives?
Okay, so I've not really included an example. So you'll find a lot of libraries. Many programs you'll download will require libraries to run. Not many, in fact, you could say all. Okay, you could simply say all programs that you download and compile will require some library to represent. Now, if you're compiling a simple C program like testlink.c without calling any special functions, even this program links to a dynamic library called libc.so. Okay, so this libc.so is present on all Linux systems. Okay, so you would download a program which needed a specific library. For example, there's a lot of scientific programs which you would download. They would need some linear algebra or math libraries. So before running this program or before compiling it, you would need these libraries to be present. So you would need to download these libraries, these .so files, or you would have to create them, you would have to compile them. So generally commercial libraries are distributed as .so files. And open source libraries are generally distributed as source. So if you have an open source library, you could compile the .so files. Okay, and then put the .so files in some library location and then compile your program so that it links to them. So some common libraries which you will be encountering in your work is like MKL, okay, they're called math kernel libraries. Okay, LAPACK, these are linear algebra libraries. So these libraries come in different names. For example, there's an MKL, there's a math kernel library, linear algebra libraries, that is distributed by Intel. Okay, so those are a bunch of SO files which you'll put somewhere, or .a files. It'll have both files. The same library will be present as a static archive, a .a, and be present as a .so also. Okay, it will have some standard functions, like linear algebra functions. Now you could download another library, an open source library like Atlas. Okay, Atlas has a different library name. Okay, its library name is libatlas.so, it's different. The Intel one would be libmkl.so. But the functions inside the Atlas, since both of these are LAPACK libraries, LAPACK is a standard, just like POSIX, LAPACK is a standard, it has some specific function names. So Atlas has the same functions as the functions defined in Intel. But the code might be different. Okay, so there might be a function to perform like vector-vector multiplication, okay, dot product. Okay, but the code in one might be different from the code in another, but they'll have the same function name, same symbol name. So when you compile your program, you could link to either the Intel library or you could link to the Atlas library. So your program, as long as the program sees the name of the symbol, so suppose you're calling dot product with two parameters, okay, two vectors. So your program doesn't know, the program doesn't care where the library comes from. As long as it finds a library with that function defined in it, it's going to link to it. So this is one more advantage of having dynamic libraries. So you can link to multiple versions of the same library function. Okay, so you have your function dot product, you have a free implementation, okay, an open source implementation, you have a commercial implementation. Okay, you can link to any one of them. Your program doesn't need to know whether the implementation is different. So the code could be different. So that's another advantage of having dynamic libraries.
So in both, you said that while preprocessing, which actually copies entire header files into the code.
Right.
Suppose we are putting some header files which we are not actually using in the code, will it make our job slow?
It might make the preprocessing step slow, but once your compilation is complete, once you convert into assembly language, it doesn't matter.
Suppose I don't have a common code but specific code to my requirement. So creating an hash file and then linking it dynamically or statically, I mean, can't we do write as just a make file and link all the objects into our executable and do it? I mean, you want it to be fast.
You're talking about this step?
I mean, either of the two. I mean, we need not do the archive thing, but
okay,
directly link the object file to the our binary.
Yeah, so I told you that linking the object files individually, if you have a large number of object files, it becomes inconvenient, right?
But can you make files?
Yeah, you can do that. You can even write a script, right? You can write a script that looks for all the O files and puts it over there, right? But how would you distribute it? It becomes difficult to distribute also, right? So the archive is an easy way to distribute it, plus to compile. So it's not only for compilations, for distribution also, right?
But while running the job, it has to de-archive, right? I mean, it has to unzip the library file and then...
Yeah, so that happens only during compile time. Okay, so when you're compiling, it actually opens up the archive and takes the code of the object files and puts it there. But that's only once. So when you run it, the code is actually in your file. So it doesn't slow your code down.
Like talking about the open source and the closed one, dynamic libraries can have same object file names. Then when the program runs a particular library, it calls that particular library always.
Yeah, so I was talking about this, not the same library name, I was talking about the same function names. So you can have two libraries from two distributors with the same function names defined in them. Right? So suppose you had your square root function. Okay, you could create your own square root function and you could download a square root function really fast one from Intel. Okay, your library names would be different, but during compilation you can choose which one you link to. Okay? And if the libraries have the exact same calling conventions, okay, you can actually replace one library with another during runtime, and the program would never know. Okay. Any other questions?